Welcome to L&D Disrupt, the podcast dedicated to helping you overcome workplace challenges and prepare for the future of work today. I'm your host, Nelson Sibelingen, and I'll be speaking with the movers, shakers, and path breakers in L&D who are reshaping their organizations right now. Join us each week as we delve into the highs and lows of work in the industry to get to the real nitty-gritty stuff that you actually care about.
But I think a good starting point is to hear a little bit for context about your journey into the L&D space, where you came from and how you sort of found that transition. So Sarah, do you want to kick us off?
Sure. Hi, everyone. So excited to see some familiar faces and some new friends, too. So, my journey was pretty non-traditional, and I never even knew learning and development was a thing that anyone could do. So I started off, I could talk about this for hours, but basically, I started out in sales. So I was working for a property management company. I was leasing apartments. I never quite really knew what I wanted to do. I knew I wanted to help people, but didn't know in what way, shape, or form. So I fell in love with that. I fell in love with helping people find their homes and really get to experience like what went into creating a home for them, and saw people have babies and get married and get dogs. And so it was a really, really wonderful experience for me. And it's really where I started to tap in and to understand, without knowing it at the time, what it looked like to get to and receive really good training, what it looked like to get onboarded, what it also looked like to get bad training too. But again, all that clicked a little bit later. So as I moved in my sales career, I moved into sales management and I was leading teams. And that's really where things started to come into play a little bit more for me. I started to really dabble in creating videos for my team and setting up these weekly meetings and always having these job aids. I didn't know they were called job aids at the time, right? So all of these little things that I was doing, which were learning and development, but still didn't have the language for that. So it wasn't until the company I was working for completely overhauled their learning and development and brought in an incredible team that I went to a 2-day long leadership development course and class and training, which kind of seems that was many years ago now. So those things don't quite exist like that anymore. Now that we have this virtual world that we're in, but it was the first time I sat there and I experienced it and thought, wow, this is someone's job. Someone's job is to do this, to stand in front of the room, to facilitate these conversations. And so for me, right after that training, I walked up to the head of learning and development at the time, and I said, how can I do this? And they said, do you know this particular software? And I said, yes. They said, great. Do you want to train it? And I said, yes. And they said, okay, great. You're the software trainer. And so I literally became a trainer overnight. I had no idea what the heck I was doing. I had never formally trained anyone before, although I had. And so I just got started and I made a lot of mistakes and I learned a lot and eventually moved into the corporate training side. And then from there, very quickly led the department. And since then have led L&D for 4 different organizations. And then almost 2 years ago, we're going to celebrate that in like a week or 2 weeks, I left my full-time role as a director of learning and development for a real estate organization and officially started the Overnight Trainer, where I coach people to find, land, love, and grow in their L&D careers.
Nice. We spoke a lot about learning by doing, just getting stuck into something before. So it's cool to hear that was part of your journey. And Lauren, how about yourself?
Oh, gosh. So my story is pretty interesting. I'm very proud of the fact that I have never had the same job twice. So I've been a cartoon character. I've been a hairdresser's assistant. I was a travel agent for a while. I studied psychology and business at university. So obviously very useful for booking travel, recruitment, and then teaching HR people how to use a people management software that we make at Intelli, all the way through into learning and development, which sounds like a very disjointed kind of what is this person doing career path. And my resume is very exciting to look at. But one thing that's always been the same throughout, and I really only realized it in the past couple of years, is that even though the jobs have been different, the theme has been the same, which is motivational explaining. So whether it's booking someone on a holiday somewhere that they've never been before, they've never experienced, and getting them excited to understand it, or, you know, right now where I'm teaching our people internally how to teach other people how to use our software, it's always been that similar path of taking the experience, making sure that it has the right impact for people, and just giving other people that light bulb moment where they can go and do what they need to do with their day. you know, that is the thing that just lights me up and brings me so much joy, is helping someone else solve one of their problems. In hindsight, L&D should have been where I was all along. Like, I was the kid, you know, when I was 5 years old, making fake schoolwork for my sister in, you know, in a classroom on holidays. And I've come full circle and ended up where I am now. So really happy. It's been about a year and a half now. So, you know, lots of things have changed in that time, but yeah, I'm definitely where I need to be, which is cool.
You'd be surprised by how often it comes full circle. Like, you do something as a kid and you try a bunch of different things. Actually, I heard a good interview with a podcast host the other day where he said when he was a kid, he just sat on his own in his room listening to audiobooks. And now, like, sort of 20 years later, he's just a podcast host. So it's the equivalent of today. He's just come full circle. But yeah, one thing you kind of both mentioned there actually a little bit about motivation and sort of why you wanted to get into it. And I think that's probably an interesting place to start. It's how can you identify sort of what your motivation is for getting into the space and sort of finding the right role, and sort of a role you love but can also do well. So just curious if you have any thoughts around how people can help find their own motivation. And because actually, Sarah, you mentioned something interesting last time we spoke. It was to not confuse the reasons, i.e. remote working, benefits, pay, career development, for the motivations, because the motivation is different and it probably sort of gives you more fuel for longer. So open-ended question.
Yeah. So, you know, really your why is what's going to keep you going when things feel really hard, right? Your why is going to keep you going when maybe your reasons aren't quite there yet, right? Your why is going to keep you going. So I think as far as, you know, finding that why and that motivation, the number one question I encourage people to think about is, what's the legacy you want to leave behind, right? And I encourage my clients, some of them are in this room right now, but one of the questions to think and visualize is, you know, at the end of this long, beautiful, fruitful career that you have, you know, imagine that you're there and you're at your retirement party. Like, what are people saying about you? What's the impact that you left? And I think when you're able to start to backwards engineer into that, that is what will fuel you. So when maybe you know, don't get that role, or you're having a hard time finding something that, you know, meets your what the right role at the right company looks like for you, rather than that letting that take you down, you can say, well, that just means that I haven't found the right role that matches what it is I'm really meant to be doing. So that why piece, you have to start with it. I almost think about it in terms of, you know, if you are, a lot of people say lay your foundation first, right? But really, before you lay a foundation, you have to clear the land. And so your why really helps you do that and start with a fresh slate, so then you can lay a solid foundation on top of that.
Yeah. And I think, Lauren, it sounds like you kind of had that organic light bulb moment yourself, because you said that it was training other people and then seeing an impact that kind of gave you that spark. And that is a real motivation to sort of help others and drive performance, I guess.
Absolutely. So for me, it was definitely like a bolt of lightning moment. When I was working in recruitment, we used to do group interviews once a week. And, you know, there were six of us in the team. We'd take it in turns. 30 people would come into the room. We would spend 45 minutes telling them about what it was like to work at this company, how amazing it was, you know, the challenges, making sure they understood how the remuneration structure worked. So it's kind of like a little onboarding moment for 45 minutes. And of the six people in my team, I was the one that would want to do it. Everyone else would feel like, you know, it was their turn. But for me, it was like, oh, today is my turn. I get to do this. And I loved it. And I had this light bulb moment at one stage where I realized that 45 minutes out of a 40-hour work week wasn't really a great ratio of stuff I love doing to stuff I don't love doing. I wonder if there's something out there where I could do this more often. And it turns out that, yeah, there's an entire industry, there's an entire branch and discipline where this can be your job all the time, is teaching people stuff so that they can get to where they want to be. So, I started doing some study. I did my certificate 4 in training and assessment, which, if you're not in Australia, it kind of qualifies you to deliver registered training across anywhere in Australia. You don't have to have it, but I found it really helpful in terms of teaching me how to structure, you know, sessions and courses, and make sure that when you're assessing information that you're doing it in a fair and valid way. So I found it super useful. I'm actually one unit away from finishing my diploma, which is like the next level up now. So super excited.
Nice. Congratulations.
Encouragement, everyone.
Yeah, exactly. Leave some encouragement in the chat. It's one more unit. I think that's doable. You can do this. You can see I've not missed my life coach calling. I'm not exactly full of beans and the most encouraging person, I guess. But yeah, one thing I wanted to pick up on actually was transferable skills, because essentially, and again, it's a thing you both alluded to there, even without directly having worked in L&D, there will be things you've done in other roles that kind of map directly on to how you can perform an L&D role, right? So it might be from that sales background, it might be from customer success and enablement, but I think sometimes people get caught up on thinking they have to have this big portfolio or they have to be qualified before they start applying for jobs or trying to get into that space. But yeah, I think really it's about how do we identify which skills could be transferable from sort of previous roles?
Well, I'll say it's pretty much every skill is transferable. So that's the beauty of learning and development. It's like it's the blessing and the curse, I'll say, right? Is that every skill is transferable. So then you say, okay, well, where do I start with that, right? So getting really clear, and I think Lauren is such an amazing example, like the pinnacle of example in saying, wow, this is something I really enjoy doing. I find energy in doing this. Where else can I do this and how can I do this more? And the reality is L&D, there is not one skill that is specific and owned by learning and development. There's not one. I dare someone to name one, because it does not owned, you know, and trademarked by learning and development. These skills are, L&D is beautiful because it's an amalgamation of all these transferable skills that come together to help people grow in their careers, in their companies, and, you know, reach those goals. So I think it's just really, really important for you to do the self-assessment, just like Lauren did. You know, here's what I really enjoy doing. Here's what brings me energy. Here's what brings me joy. Here's what I would love to spend 40 hours a week on instead of 45 minutes a week on. Now, what does that look like in terms of an L&D career? And, you know, I was just talking about this to my clients earlier. There's almost 1.4 million just in the US. So actually you need to do the number globally, but 1.4 million L&D and L&D adjacent roles. There's going to be something in there, many things in there that are going to align with what it is you actually want to do.
Yeah, I guess, is it more than a case of looking at it with fresh eyes? So like you said, there's no skill that's universally applicable to L&D, but you could say, like for me, for example, coming from a marketing background, I can see so many kind of flaws or pitfalls people falling into when it comes to creating content, to promoting content. So actually, is it more like, let's try and analyze the pain point and then how can I apply my skill set there? And actually, that's probably a really good way to communicate value to people, isn't it? To say, look, I have this many years of experience in sales or marketing or customer enablement. This is how I think we can tackle this problem, and coming at it with a new set of eyes. But is that something you found as well, Lauren, coming from like many sort of different backgrounds and different skill sets to draw on? Were you able to come into that first L&D role and go, I can use this skill from this job and to solve this problem?
100%. So, you know, the first thing I said is that I've never had the same role twice. I would definitely think of a career more as a scavenger hunt than a race or an attempt to climb a ladder. You know, no bit of energy or nothing that you learn in any job is ever wasted. You know, in my role in learning and development now, when I'm getting people, you know, to do things and to learn things and, you know, just to, you know, engage. You know, I used to be a cartoon character. So at one stage, getting people to do what you need to do without being able to talk to them, just bringing energy to the room with your physical presence, you know, so feeling confident and not being afraid to be a bit silly. You know, sometimes people get a bit scared to be as enthusiastic as they truly want to be. And if you don't have that much embarrassment about it, you know, you can show that authentic excitement and it really does resonate with people. You know, selling anything, you know, but like travel, it's expensive. You can't experience it until you've actually done it. And then, you know, you understand. Very similar to getting somebody to follow you along a journey, you know, whether it's people in a workshop or whether it's, you know, a leader in the business trying to get them to get on board with an investment that you want them to make. It's still the same thing. You have to get them to see that vision and to come along with you to understand what's in it for them. So, yeah, I would say that no skill that you pick up in any role is something that you cannot draw upon in a learning and development position. And the really cool thing is that you are the only person that has that unique mix of skills and experiences and knowledge. You know, your back will be at the wall and you will pull this thing out of your hat from 6 years ago that you thought you would never use again. And everyone in the room will stare at you and go, where did you come up with that? So yeah, you have to back yourself. And even if it doesn't feel like there's a lot in the bag, it's a big bag of experience. You've got it in there.
Yeah, it reminds me of when I used to do exams and I didn't know the answer. So I'd just write down everything I thought was relevant to the question. And then once you start writing that out, actually you do find more stuff in there that does apply to what you're trying to convince people and convey the message. And yeah, I guess kind of at the heart of this is something I stole from your podcast as well, Sarah, that you said before, was that you're more qualified than you think you are. And I guess part of it is mindset as well, right? Like if you want to either enter that first role or do really well in that first role, half of the battle is believing that you are qualified enough to do it. And then, like Lauren said, that confidence and enthusiasm carries over into how well you convince people that there's value in what you're trying to do, that you can take them on that journey to the right metrics, the kind of performance that we're trying to get to.
Yeah. One thing I want to say about that too, it's a lot of people think that they have to get the confidence first and then figure out the skills, but it's actually flipped. That the clearer you can get on the skills that you bring to the table, the more confident you'll be in that. And so a lot of people are waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting for the confidence and like, I got to get the confidence. And they'll actually go and get more certifications and learn more and like upskill. But really you've had these skills laying here in that big bag that Lauren's talking about all along. And those are what's really going to make you confident. You need to pull them out of the bag and say, hey, here they all are. Like pull them out and line them up and look at them. And that's what gives you then that confidence piece.
Yeah. I'm such a geek, but I've mentioned this on the show before. It's called the confidence competence loop, but basically competence is what gives you the confidence to go and do the thing. So like weightlifters practice for hours doing the patterns for weightlifting, and then that gives them the skills and the actual confidence from the competence to go to a meet and then nail like a massive lift, right? So yeah, I think it is like, I guess part of it as well actually is, are there ways for people to build kind of practice scenarios where they could put some of this into practice before maybe taking it to the table for L&D? Have you ever found any value in that kind of stress testing an idea before you take it to other people?
I think that's where networking really can come in too, right? Where earlier you talked to one of the points I wanted to circle back to was understanding the challenges. And part of, you know, I call it finding your learning and development niche, which is the intersection between your skills, your interests, and your values, right? That's the sweet spot for you. And it's not just a job title. It's more than that. But part of finding your L&D niche is understanding what are the challenges that are out there and which challenges do I actually want to solve, right? So I think that piece, that rather than having to go out there and constantly test, that will give you a more of a quick fix in a way of, wow, that sounds like a really cool challenge. That does not. Like, I would want to do that. I would definitely not want to do that. So, you know, you can then say, okay, you know, in those networking conversations, you find out, well, what skills are they utilizing to overcome those challenges? Those are skills I have and want to use. Those are skills I have and don't want to use. So by process of elimination, you can really start to almost see yourself in it versus having to try it out. 1.4 million jobs, it's hard to test them all out, but if you can start to categorize by challenge and those skills needed to solve those challenges, it helps bypass that a little bit. And I don't know if Lauren, you have something to add as far as testing the waters go.
Absolutely. So I just wanted to talk about like what you said about identifying, you know, this is a challenge that I want to take on. This is one that I do not want to take on. You know, I think for a lot of us, it's kind of ingrained that we have strengths and we have weaknesses and we have to work on the weaknesses until they become strengths. But the thing is, if you're investing your time and effort, like get your weaknesses up to a point where they don't hurt you anymore, but it's so much more rewarding and engaging to spend your energy and time on the things that you are already good at. And when it comes to testing stuff out, you know, you don't have to be in an L&D role to start trying out learning and development stuff. When I was working in recruitment, we had a lot of new people that joined our team. And for me, one of the things that I just kind of did in a lunch break because it was really fun for me is I made a one-pager chart for new recruiters on these are the kinds of conversations that you want to have. Here's like your top five things that you need to be worried about. And I completely lost track of time. I was making it pretty and I was making it fun and I put little pictures in there and, you know, like I had a really great afternoon and, okay, maybe I didn't make all the phone calls I was supposed to make that day. So lesson to everyone, keep balancing what you're supposed to be doing. But the piece of paper that I produced that I was doing for fun, for my own pleasure, that was something that someone else could use, but I could also look at and say, right, I did this. I did this in an hour and a half with very limited training, zero resources. It was in PowerPoint. This is a prototype. This is a low investment thing that I've tried out for myself and I've, you know, had a win. Imagine what I could do if I had, you know, the full time and the energy. So that confidence, competence loop, you know, this is me just doing my practice lifts in the gym. Like I'm ready to go out there and make something real now. And if I happen to show that to somebody, you know, and there's a opportunity down the track, great. But if it's just for me, that's totally fine too.
Yeah.
Do the things that bring you joy, because if you can get better at them and get paid for it, that's the whole point of this.
Yeah. No, that is the perfect summary, that if you want to start doing something, you don't need someone to give you the job title to do it, to go and do it, right? Like, and the irony is actually, if you do it off your own back, you'll build up evidence that you can do it, as opposed to telling people you can do it. You can actually show people you can do it. So like you said, if you're passionate about getting into L&D and you're already in a company where you think there's a chance to pivot, then you could just say, is there a way for me to get involved in producing X resources? Or just like you said, produce some cheat sheets off your own back. Like something you mentioned to me before, Lauren, was the context as well. Like, why is the business hiring L&D people? What's the context behind that? If you understand the context, you'll understand the pain points. So let's say the L&D team is kind of being created internally because we need to enable ourselves and customer success people to close more deals or retain more customers. If there's a way you can create resources independently that kind of solve that pain point and then distribute them to the team and they do have an effect, then you build up this bank of evidence that actually I can go and do the job. I've shown you I can do it. So, you know, invest in me, give me a chance to make that transition, I guess.
Absolutely. And an added bonus of doing that as well. And this is something, so where I work, we're a growing tech business. You know, there's sort of about 80 of us. And until I started in the role, we didn't have a learning and development manager. We didn't have learning and development full stop. It was managed entirely sort of by managers and individuals in their teams. And so we had this short-term opportunity where we were trying out a learning and development manager position internally, and we had it to solve a specific problem, which was making sure that everybody in the business, because we were growing quite rapidly at that stage, and we had new people teaching new people how the platform worked, which, you know, when you photocopy a photocopy, it doesn't always come out so great. So we needed kind of this centralized source of information about how that this platform works, how it benefits people, why is it amazing. And we didn't have that. So, you know, when it comes to like proving yourself and, you know, being in those high stakes situations, this was a role that was only going to exist for 6 months. So I had a very clear, this is what the business needs to see in terms of results. This is the outcome that I want, which is I want, you know, in 6 months' time, our CEO to go, wow, we absolutely needed this position. We needed to keep this, like, let's put some more investment into it. If that's what I want to see, how do I get back to the starting point of what I need to do to make that outcome happen? So, yeah, start with the end in mind, I would say.
Yeah. Is there any sort of thoughts on, I know we've been on a lot of different tangents there between the three of us.
But oh, great one.
Yeah. Any sort of thoughts? I want to take a few audience questions in a moment. But, yeah, any thoughts on that point of the benefit of just doing something and seeing how it sticks, or how we can communicate to people internally, any sort of tips and thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think, you know, I sign off on everything that was just said. And what I'll add to it is it's also looking and saying, well, where have I already done this? It may not have been in a quote unquote traditional sense, which I saw, I think it was Aaron's question come through around traditional L&D, but it may not have been in a traditional sense. And I wrote down, what is traditional? I wrote that because really, who defines that? So not only where can I start to do this, but also have I actually already done this? And I think a lot of people get stuck and think, well, I have to do it a certain way. I have to do it in corporate. I have to do it in this type of role. I have to do it at this type of place. But it's, no, you've done it. How do you now explain that and bring that in and say, oh, I've put together, like for me, oh, I've put together job aids before. I didn't know it was called that. Definitely wasn't my job to do that. But I saw a need and I did that. So now 13 years later, I can say, oh, I've been making job aids for 13 years. So I think it's just important that, yes, a part of smashing your new role is looking for those opportunities. And a part of getting into your new role is being able to say, wow, I've actually already done this, whether it's in a traditional sense or not.
Yeah. Yeah. Don't get bogged down in the terminology. I think that's perfect for any role. It's like you said, who defines what traditional is or who defines what a job aid is, right? You've been creating stuff that enables people to be better at their job. And, you know, that is a job aid, but it's also, if we get stuck in the loop of job aids, we'll only think of like very niche pigeonhole type stuff. So, yeah, I do want to, you mentioned Erin there, and I do want to come back to this question to just paraphrase it to you. Building an LMS from scratch in an organization, there's a lot of ownership over the L&D, but the problem is, as it's a small organization, there's not much room for career growth. So would there be any advice on pivoting from maybe a more of a traditional L&D, we'll come back to the word traditional, but into like a role, yeah, into a more traditional L&D role where you can kind of maximize those transferable skills from the current role? So I guess it's like once you reach that ceiling internally, how do you maybe like bank your internal skills and then go and find a role somewhere else?
Yeah. Well, I think I'll go back and say like, what is like, how are we defining traditional? And I think it's something to really, really dive into, because who defined? No one. There's no definition for what is traditional L&D and what is not. That there's a nice big gray wiggly line in between what's traditional and what's not. So it's a blurred line too, and for a good reason. So when I read this, Erin, when you said you've built an LMS from scratch, you design resources, and you have a lot of ownership over organizational L&D, sounds like you have traditional L&D experience. So it really is just capitalizing on those things, not only the things that you've done, but taking inventory, similar to Lauren's story, right? Taking in inventory of, here's all of the things that I've done, but now this is actually what I want to do with that. So maybe you don't want to design resources anymore, or maybe you don't want to build an LMS from scratch, but you really want to focus on owning organizational L&D. Well, focus on what are the skills that I've done to make that happen so far? And what does that look like in my next role, traditional or not? So I think we throw away the word traditional because it really, it's like time it was invented, right? Like who knows? Who knows what time it really is, right? It's a different time for all of us right now. Lauren, I don't have anything to add to that.
Something that I would add to it, and this is based on personal experience. Gary, you said the word like once you've hit that ceiling internally. Depending on how much you love working where you are, you know, and if there is no sort of pressing issues to leave, it might be worth checking whether how solid that ceiling really is. You know, if you've done these things, like, you know, setting up an LMS from scratch is a huge deal. So congratulations and well done there. Like, you should definitely pat yourself on the back for doing that. And that is very valuable to the business. You know, the fact that they have invested your time in doing this and invested in an LMS, it might be an indication that this is something that is of value to the organization, you know, and maybe with the size that they are or the capacity that they have financially, it might not be a full-time learning and development position. But, you know, I've seen people where they actually end up doing split roles. So they might do their real job 4 days a week, and then they, you know, spend 1 day a week dedicated as learning and development. But, you know, it might be worth seeing if there is more capacity for that kind of official recognition internally, if you are happy where you are.
Yeah. Yeah. I think part of it as well is maybe starting with, if you did get in that position where you needed to leave, do what we spoke about before, start with that North Star and work backwards. So I often think like we give this advice when people are going to look for learning tech, but don't go and look for an LMS or an LXP. Work out what your pain points are. Work out what you want to be doing or what problems you can solve, and then try and find job descriptions that match that, because you might actually find that something might not have L&D in the title, but it might be the perfect fit for you based on what your North Star is, what your motivations are, the skills you have, the things you enjoy doing. So I would guess, yeah, just try and cast like a wider net when, if you do come to that point where you're looking for jobs. That's something I found personally, because people use so many different words and buzzwords and things in titles that often if you just get into the description itself, then yeah, the perfect job might not be named the right way, which will be a bugbear for me as someone in copywriting. But there you go. Hope that was useful. Got another sort of job-based question Jess asked in the chat, that she has an interview on Friday for an L&D role. Good luck, first of all. And then also, do you have any tips for the interview? I know we spoke about a few things here about kind of compiling evidence that you're good at what you do, maybe build that bank of transferable skills so you can present it on Friday. But yeah, I guess outside of that, any sort of tips that you'd give?
My number one tip is don't over-prepare. We can get like really, really, really caught up in trying to know everything, say the right things, don't say the wrong things, learn all the values, do all this research, prepare for every single question you might be asked. And the more that we over-prepare, what happens is when we get asked a normal question that we under normal circumstances would be able to answer, we didn't rehearse that question. So then our brains are just flooding with like, what else did I rehearse? What else did I rehearse? And we show up to interviews as robots. I just had this conversation like 30 minutes ago with my career coaching group, just around like showing up authentically and really, really, really being yourself. Because if you are showing up as an inauthentic robotic version of you, and that's what they end up hiring, imagine how exhausting that's going to be to keep that up once you're working there. So really, really get clear on just who you are and the skills you bring to the table. And you know, what are examples of moments where you've been really proud in your career, where you've made a lot of impact? Those will carry weight. And when you get asked a question, you can always refer back to those stories that you have versus the rehearsed answers. So don't over-prepare. Number one tip.
Cool.
Absolutely.
Lauren, how about yourself?
I would also, and it depends on who you're speaking to for the interview, but the questions that you ask are also very powerful. So, you know, like we all know about asking the questions that make us look good and telling them that our weakness is being perfectionists and all that stuff, which is very 2003 now. But the questions that you ask is a real opportunity to make sure that this is the right role for you as well, you know. So asking what is this, you know, what is the aim of this role? What are you trying to achieve in the business? What does the organization need from learning and development so that you can then know, am I in a position to help them get there? You know, that'll help with your confidence as well. You know, if they need sales enablement or they need, you know, leadership training or anything else like that, and those are things that you've got a background in, like that helps you show that you're the right person for the job. But it also shows that you've got the strategic mindset, you know, really asking, what are you trying to do here and how can I help? That's always a winner in pretty much every job interview, I reckon.
Yeah,
exactly, Sarah. You're interviewing them as much as they're interviewing you.
Yeah.
It has to be a good fit for everyone.
No, exactly. I think at that point as well is like, how are we establishing the pain point? Like, why are they hiring someone in L&D? And if you can nail that early on in the interview or even get that context before you have the interview, you can kind of tailor your responses a bit, not over-preparing them, but you can kind of build those bullet points that you can refer back to and say, like, if you're hiring someone to improve retention, for example, you could go look at all the Glassdoor reviews and see if there's any stuff in there that you can prepare ahead of time. I guess it's, yeah, once you know why they're hiring and you can kind of map your experience onto that. Sarah, just to come back, you mentioned about the sort of coaching groups that you've been involved in and stuff. Is there any sort of steps you normally give people to follow when it comes to as particularly an L&D interview, but like, is there a process? Is there kind of like steps we should be doing?
Yeah, I mean, there definitely are. I will say it's not a one size fits all. So anyone who tells you follow this step in this order, they're probably telling you that from their own personal experience. And Lauren said something really, really, really special earlier, which was, you are the only one who has your skills. You're the only one who has your experience. You're the only one who has your strengths in the order that you have them, right? So following someone else's step-by-step is most likely not going to work for you. So I think there's a big piece of it is getting clear on what, like, there's overall tenets, right? First and foremost, I'll say you have to find your niche. You have to know what it is you want to do, how you want to do it, and for who do you want to do it for? Like what values you want to share from an organization. So that is the foundation. Once you clear the land, that's the foundation to set. Then it kind of gets into it's not linear, but it's, you know, kind of more like this, where things flow in and out, because there's a big part of, you know, applying for roles, creating a marketing plan for yourself. So your resume, your cover letter, your LinkedIn, right? So I look at the three pillars as far as, you know, being able to have your own personal brand. So what that's on a scale as well, you know, creating a LinkedIn that is optimized and gets you noticed, to have that marketing, you know, those marketing documents that allow you to apply for the dream roles at the dream companies. And then also networking and building that L&D network around your niche. So again, it's not a linear process, but the more that you can kind of infuse and kind of tap into all three of those, maybe you hang out in two more than the other, but the more that you're able to infuse all of those, the quicker your L&D career transition is going to be, for sure. It can say that from the hundreds of clients I've had over the last couple of years, like those three pillars. And then really, once you have those in place, you have a strong network, you have a great personal brand, you know, have these kick-ass marketing documents that are highlighting all of your skills, interviewing becomes easy. Like it becomes second nature because you've done that work. So it really does start with you. It starts with you doing the work to figure out, what's your why? What is it you want to do? How do you want to do it? Where do you want to do it? And then from there, really following the path of least resistance, as far as what does networking look like for you? What is applying to roles look like for you? What is building a personal brand look like for you? Not the 10,000 different ways other people do it.
Yeah. You actually teed up the perfect segue there. But one thing I wanted to ask you both about was that power of the personal brand. So it's something I'm trying to build out myself at the moment, and I'm seeing this from both sides. But a personal brand, like you said, it makes you more discoverable on LinkedIn. When people go to your profile before, like after you apply, or when they're going to interview you, they're going to see that you're putting thought leadership content out there if you're posting regularly. But I guess it also gives you a bit of an aura of credibility internally. So what I'm finding is, in my day-to-day conversations with people, I'm not going to be telling them this sort of leadership stuff. But if they're seeing that I'm posting it in an external way, it gives me a bit more credibility, I think, internally. So if you want people to buy into your L&D approach or whatever it is you're trying to get people on board with, if they're seeing that you're a thought leader outside of the workspace, then it probably will give you more credibility internally. And I guess, Lauren, is that something you found also coming from a different background, having like a different skill set, does that help not only differentiate you, but help you kind of build that personal brand that then also gets people on board?
Yeah. So having that kind of really diverse background and a lot of diverse different interests means that when I am, you know, sharing stuff and talking about stuff, I guess what people kind of know me for is pulling these different threads from things that are at first glance completely unrelated and weaving them together into something that is new and makes sense. You know, everyone at work jokes that my superpower is analogies. I used to teach customers how to use our platform by giving, like, you know, analogies of growing plants and buying tickets to various different theme parks and that sort of stuff. And so now when I start talking about analogies or explaining things to people, that's kind of what they come to expect from me. And as soon as I start getting into, oh, this is like this, people go, oh, okay, cool. All right, I'm ready to listen now. Thanks for explaining. So yeah, I guess that's my personal brand, that and the bright pink hair at the moment.
Yeah. Nice. I love an analogy. So that explains why we get on so well. Sarah, how about yourself? Like, obviously a big part of when you're helping people apply is and build that kind of presence they need to go and apply for the jobs. How do you see the role of the personal brand, and like how can people build a really good one that gets them in the right spheres to be noticed for the right jobs?
Yeah. And I think personal brands on a scale, right? So some people might have heard you say the word like create content and be a thought leader, and they just like X'd out of the screen and said, goodbye, I'm done here. Right. And some people are like, yeah, like let me like write all the content. So it's on a scale, right? So at the very bare minimum of creating your personal brand, I would say utilizing LinkedIn and having an optimized profile, right? So you're, you know, a picture where people can see who you are, a banner that's not just a blank, you know, a blank fill in an image here, your headline that's niche aligned, right? What is it that you do? How do you do it? Where do you want to do it for, right? So, and it's optimized so people can find you. An about section that actually talks about you, dives into your why, lets people behind the curtain a little bit more. Your experience that outlines your experience from a lens of what it is you want to do, right? Showcasing that through what you've done in the past. So that's at the bare minimum of just having a great LinkedIn profile. So if someone's searching, like, oh, I want a program manager, you know, who, you know, whatever, that you're popping up there, right? So that's at the bare minimum. But on the other end of the spectrum, to your point, right, then there is creating some of your own original thought leadership. You know, what are, again, when you think about your niche, that's why this is like your North Star and so important. You can say, all right, well, what are those challenges in my niche? What are the skills that I can speak to? Maybe coaching is a really big part of what it is you want to do in your next role. So you share coaching tips, or, you know, share a story of the time you coach someone, right? And then in between that, maybe you're not ready for that, but you're sharing, resharing an article, right? Or resharing a quote, or, you know, engaging with other people on LinkedIn on their content. So you can really run the scale there, but at that bare minimum, just make sure people can find you. And when they find you, they're like, oh yeah, this is the person, like, I gotta slide into their LinkedIn DMs because I want them to be on our team.
Yeah. Yeah, great piece of advice I heard was just to treat your LinkedIn page like it's a landing page. So, you know, your about section needs to be as compelling as a website landing page would be. Like,
yeah,
you said,
I love that. I love that. Yes, I'm stealing that.
Feel free. I stole it from someone else. So we'll keep stealing other people's. But this is actually a great point, because I'm going to go on a segue here, but I'm doing a workshop at the end of March about how you can build your own content strategy. And like, part of that I was telling people this week is, very few people have unique takes or like unique ideas. We just have unique perspectives. Like, if we're in marketing, 90% of us do the same things every day. There's very few people really innovating. But what you do have is a unique take or opinion on the things we all do every day. And that is one way you can do that. So if people want to join, I just put the link in the chat. And yeah, we'll be doing a session. It's about 30, 40 minutes, giving you tips how, even if you don't post, you can become sort of seen as a thought leader through your comment strategy, or how you can just build a process of creating ideas. So yeah, I think that's a great point. Make sure you're discoverable. You know, like, if you want a job in L&D, adding that to your bio, adding it to your description is going to make you found by the right people. Also, you'll get a lot of spam from potentially recruiters, so just prepare yourself for that as well. But yeah, and then Lauren's got a great point there as well. If you just follow the right people and the right hashtags, your newsfeed will be full of the right stuff anyway. There was a question I wanted to come back to, actually. I'm just scrolling back up now, but I'm not sure. I think they're joining on their phone because there's no name. But just to, the problem is, a lot of time they're in an L&D position. Their staff are saying that they don't have opportunities to progress or develop, they're kind of trying to bring more L&D opportunities to staff, but not really knowing where to start. So I guess, yeah, either of you have any advice on, I guess the idea is buy-in, getting people to buy in to the L&D opportunities they're getting anyway.
I would say that there are two places that you could start. You can start at the top or at the bottom. So when I'm talking about starting at the top, you know, if there isn't these opportunities for, you know, development or career progression and leadership training, is there a need for it in the business? And spoiler alert, the answer is pretty much always yes, there is a need for it. They just don't know it. So it's about surfacing that need. You know, what can you do to get the right information in front of the right people so that they see these things are a priority? Maybe all of them at once is a bit too much. So, you know, just choose one, like succession planning. That's kind of a good buzzword that a lot of businesses, you know, the leaders will prick up their ears and go, right, actually, I do need to have a plan in place to make sure that we can continue to run as a business regardless of what happens. So, you know, definitely get the attention of the people that can make the decisions for investment. When I talk about starting at the bottom as well is, okay, so people are saying that you don't have these opportunities. Can you get more information about what they do want? You know, is there is there something specific that people want? Is there a certain skill that people, you know, are looking for or that they need, or they just want more clarity on how career progression works? The more that you can investigate that and find out what people are really needing and feeling like they're lacking, then you can pick one small thing on that list. You know, what is one thing that's that low-hanging fruit that you can really make a difference in that people see, and then they talk about it, and then you get the momentum, and then you can sort of build it from the grassroots up to see the results and get people excited about it. So yeah. It's definitely a tough situation to be in, particularly, you know, when there's a lot of constraints on you, but burn the candle at both ends, you know, go for both and see what you can do. Yeah.
I think you made the perfect point there, Lauren. It's about cutting down the time to value. So a lot of the time people try and launch this like 6-month strategy. And if the results, you're not going to see them in 6 months, then you won't get people to buy in. But if you can narrow in on a pain point that you could solve quickly and show people there's value in L&D. So even if it's just every time I look for sales resources when I'm on a call, I can't find them. If you even you just do something as simple as centralizing all of that into one place, you're reducing friction, and then people can find the value sooner, and then they'll go, oh yeah, now I can find this. L&D helped me find things that I can apply in the moments of need, is what we call them internally. But yeah, it means that you can essentially get buy-in by starting with small scale things. So our CEO Nelson calls it think big but start small. So just test something on a small scale, see if it works. If it works, iterate and grow it a bit more. But it's more about reducing time to value so people can buy in quicker, because they'll see that you're adding value. But if it's like a 6-month big bang strategy and people don't see value for 6 months, we'll lose interest over time. So yeah, I think it's more about like trying to think of the graph going up. How can I peak interest and increase it over time, rather than I've got a bunch of interest and if I take 6 months to roll this out, I'll just lose a bunch of it over time. How about yourself, Sarah? Any sort of thoughts on this buy-in issue and how we can get people to get enthusiastic?
Literally what was running through my head was low hanging fruit, and Lauren literally said it. So and I think it's important. And, you know, I was having this conversation the other day too, around how, especially people who are looking to get into L&D or make that big move, right? We get caught up in like wanting to do groundbreaking things, but we forget that like groundbreaking things, A, take a lot of time, B, take a lot of resources, and C, oftentimes our learners don't need groundbreaking. And in fact, groundbreaking would actually be pushing them away than bringing them towards. So I just loved what Lauren had said around the low hanging fruit piece, like start small, get quick value, get people to talk about it. And then, and almost I don't want to get anyone in trouble, but like ask for forgiveness, right? Like we might not ask for permission, just go ahead and do it. Like you're doing your job, right? So, I mean, if it doesn't work, come back and I'll help you find a new job. But really, you know, I think about my career, and though there's lots of times where things weren't there and I just went and created it, and it served me very well, because that's my own personal experience. But, you know, if it's low hanging fruit, if it's something as simple as, Gary, you were saying too, like just centralizing some, you know, to Lauren's point, where's the pain point? Oh, pain point just might be, we don't know where to find the resources. Or, oh, okay. I took an hour and put them on a Google Doc. Here you go. Right. So it's, we often try to overcomplicate what good learning looks like and what impactful learning looks like, when really it's just made up of lots of low hanging fruit.
Yeah, exactly. Lauren, go ahead.
I was going to say, if you want to be really efficient and clever, sometimes that fruit is already on the ground. Like there's content that everyone's creating.
Pick it up,
put it in the basket, walk off. Yeah. Like our customer success team, they meet every 2 weeks to talk about all the new features that have come out in our product. And they'll go through and talk about how it works. And they have a virtual meeting and they record it. And literally all I did was take that meeting, put the recording so that I automated it, where every 2 weeks it'll pop up in a Slack channel for our developers. And now it pops up and lets them know, this is what, you know, real people are saying about your product. This is how it works. These are the questions that they have. And I just watched that Slack channel light up with, you know, engineers going, oh, it's supposed to work this way. That's actually a bug. We'll fix that. You know, so it has the turnaround time for quality for the engineering really fast. Literally all I had to do was set up one automated thing that would share a link in a different channel. You know, and that's me optimizing the learning experience and creating a collaborative learning environment. So I put that on my skill set now.
Yeah. Often it's about facilitation. You don't need to even like avoid the temptation to just create more, like do more with what you already have and then facilitate people. Like you said, that's the perfect example there. There's two people that just need to speak to each other. and you don't like you just facilitating the conversation or even the automation between the two is a perfect way to reduce friction, show value, and you didn't even have to do anything. So work smarter, not harder. This is the motto for everything in life. And it definitely asks for forgiveness, not permission. Like if you have, well, again, I'm putting my neck on the line as well, but if you have faith in something that's going to work and it's built on data, sometimes it is best to just test it on a small scale and then come back with what you found. Because a lot of the time you can either pitch it that it worked and this is why it worked, or it failed and this is why it failed. And yeah, the worst that can happen is it goes badly. And if you can accept that,
then you're fine. What's your company going to say to you? How dare you help someone?
Yeah.
Please stop showing initiative and trying. Do not innovate.
Yes. You do. Yeah. Please stop helping people be better leaders. Please stop. If that's the response, then there's a lot of other problems we need to work through.
Cool. Again, I'm really enjoying this conversation. I didn't realize we're sort of coming up to 7 minutes to go, but I want to come back to something we spoke about really early on, and that is leveraging your network. So I think for a lot of people, if they're in a small L&D team or they're the first L&D hire, there's often not that, there are people you can leverage internally, like stakeholders, people who know the business better, but from an L&D perspective, can be maybe a bit of a lonely life. So your network and your communities can kind of make up for that. So open-ended question, how useful is it actually to lean on either colleagues, former colleagues, people in your network, the communities around you to fill the gap where you don't necessarily have a team around you?
I think it's at any point in your career, whether you're transitioning, whether you're starting new, whether you're growing, whether you're retiring, right? It doesn't matter where you are. Your network is so, so, so valuable to you. And one of the things that I coach a lot on in regards to networking is thinking about like, what are your goals in doing it? Because I think a lot of people approach their network like willy-nilly, like connect. I call it like smashing the connect button, right? People are like, smash my follow or subscribe button on YouTube. It's like smash the connect button on LinkedIn, and people get really connect happy. And then they're looking at their network like, who are these people? And how are they helping me and how am I helping them? So I think if you set some goals around what I like to call the three L's, which is how do you want to leverage your network? How do you want to learn from your network? And how do you want to lean on your network? Those three components will really help you create a network where you can tap into those different things, because sometimes you need to leverage it, sometimes you need to learn from it, and sometimes you need to lean on it. And so having really specific goals for yourself that will help you identify who comes into the circle. I would say your network is your house, right? You get to decide who comes in and you get to decide who stays out. It is not a free-for-all. I have a post coming out tomorrow that's basically talking about, and I don't know if this is just a US thing, but like a lot of people treat their networking like supermarket sweep, like just throw everything into the cart, throw everyone into the cart, like race as fast as we can. It's like, no, we have to be more intentional with it. And the more intentional you are, you're just going to see job opportunities. You're going to learn so much and grow in your own skill set. Yeah. You're going to have people to bounce ideas off of, especially if you're a team of one. So there's so much to be said for building a strong network, but you have to be intentional about it.
Yeah. No, I love that. The three L's is a great way of thinking about it. And it's about quality over quantity as well. There's no point having 10,000 connections and you can't remember who people are. I actually heard a bit of a harsh tip the other day, but it was to do with Facebook. But when it reminds you it's someone's birthday, if you can't remember why you're connected to them, actually unfriend them on their birthday. It's a bit savage, but LinkedIn will remind you that it's someone's birthday and you go, who is this guy? And then you go, right, I don't know who this guy is. He's cluttering up my LinkedIn feed. So we unfriend them on their birthday, bit savage, but yeah, that's life, I suppose.
They won't notice. They're getting all the birthday messages from people that still know them.
Yeah.
Not even.
Oh god. Lauren, how about yourself? Like, I know you've never done the same role twice. You kind of transitioned internally from a different role. So, how useful was network to you in like any of those situations?
Yeah. So everything Sarah said about, you know, mindful connections, you definitely want to know other people that are doing what you do, because it can be a little bit lonely, especially if you're a team of one. You know, I moved from a team that had five people that we were living in each other's pockets, and, you know, now it's just me. So the only thing that I would add is internal networking is incredibly important. You know, Gary, you sort of talked about a little bit earlier in terms of like seeing needs, filling needs, connecting people up with each other. I kind of make the joke at work that I'm this like lone samurai wandering between the different villages. You know, like I go and visit the sales team and I, you know, learn about them and help them with things that they need. And then I'll go on my journey to my next destination and spend time with the engineers. And then I'll come over to customer success. And because I'm this wandering traveler that goes between all the different places and don't really live anywhere specific, I know everyone. I know what everyone's doing. And just those moments of going, oh, you have a question about that. Actually, you should definitely go and talk to the marketing team because they're just about to release some content on this. So, you know, as L&D, you can also act as that connective tissue. Even if you're not creating the content yourself, by connecting people, you're still making the learning happen. You're making the knowledge sharing work. Yeah. So yeah, never underestimate that. And it's also so much fun because you get to talk to everybody in the business.
Yeah. No, exactly. I mean, if you're doing your job right, you know what people's pain points are and you know what people are good at and you know what people have got in their pipeline, their plans. So like you almost know all the perfect holy trinity to kind of link the right people to the right opportunities. So yeah, I couldn't agree more. And also your LinkedIn bio, speaking of personal brands, I think is L&D Wrangler, right? So you're wrangling all the people together. So
knowledge wrangler. I got dared to put the Robin Hood of skills. I take them from people that have got a lot and share them with those that don't.
Yeah. Do you know what? Like having something like that is so useful. My bio on LinkedIn is the best copywriter I know. And then I credit that quote to my mum. And my mum never actually said that to me, but like so many people have connected with me just off the back of like just having a bit more of a fun brand. One final tangent to end it. We've been tangent heavy, so it seems a fitting way to end because we've pretty much come to time. So obviously the best place to connect with you both, I guess, would be LinkedIn. And we'll put links to both your profiles and also the Overnight Trainer website in the post podcast email that should go out on Friday this week rather than Thursday. But yeah, just want to say thanks to everyone for joining us. I know we had a lot of first-time people here, so hopefully it was useful. We'll see you at some future sessions. The next one is actually about how you translate learning science into day-to-day L&D, so it should be another really interesting conversation. But yeah, I just want to say thank you so much to Sarah and Lauren as well for giving up your time, and I really enjoyed the conversation. I think there was a lot of useful stuff in there for people, so yeah, massive thank you.